everybody, and welcome to our webinar today on this Wednesday in April. So glad that you could join us. We're thrilled that you're here. My name is Allison O'Connor. I'm with CSU Extension in Larimer County, and I will introduce our speaker in just one moment after some housekeeping. As you probably know, CSU is an equal opportunity, access, and non-discrimination university. If there is anything we can do to accommodate your needs, please let us know. We'll have the chat open where you can contact the speakers. And then if you do have questions today on the topic presented, we will ask you to put that into the Q&A. All of our webinars are recorded, so we are recording today, and they will be cross-posted in two locations just to make it even more fun. We have it on the Cohorts blog, and we also have it on Plant Talk Colorado. I will put both of those into the chat. You can find upcoming webinars at both of those locations, as well as recorded webinars. And we do encourage you to join us every the second Wednesday of the month for these monthly webinars. Next month, we will have Dr. Jim Klett, who just retired from Colorado State University, and he will be talking about superior shrubs. You can scan the QR code. I will also put the registration link into the chat, but please join us on May 8th at noon. And because he has a lot of content to present today, I will turn it over to Dr. Tony Koski, who is our presenter. Tony will be talking about clover lawns and organic lawn care, and he is a turfgrass specialist in the Department of Horticulture and Landscape Architecture at CSU. So thanks, Tony, for being here, and thanks for everyone for joining us.
All right, thanks for being here, everyone. Most important week of the year. This is Master's Week. And it's also Allison's birthday tomorrow, so you can wish her a happy birthday. At least in Allison's life, this is the most important week of the year. And she's a golf nut. So, let's talk a little bit about clover and organic lawn management. You say, well, that's kind of an interesting combination, but actually the two go together quite well. Talk a little bit about clover. There's a lot of interest in recent years, and actually it's been very cyclical. There was a lot of interest in this 20 years ago and 15 years ago and 10 years ago. Things like this go in cycles, kind of, I don't know, fads, I guess you would call them, the turf industry. But the idea of putting clover in lawns is not new. It was intentionally done in seed mixes back in the 30s, 40s, and 50s. And then suddenly clover came to be viewed as a weed, and then we had herbicides to kill clover. But now we have a lot of interest in putting it back into lawns. So as much as everybody thinks that they're going to be on the cutting edge and they have this brand new idea for lawns, this idea is far from new. So first, I think it's important to talk about what clover is in the first place. And the species that's most often talked about as far as being used in lawns is the one's called white clover or Dutch clover or Ladino clover, trifoliate repens, and repens means creeping. So this is a creeping stoloniferous plant. Here's a little thing. It is not native to North America. So I find it kind of ironic and a little bit humorous that people, they like to pick on Kentucky bluegrass. And I know there are some of you out there right now. That's okay. You won't hurt my feelings. But they want to replace bluegrass because they say it's not native. And one of the first plants they think about is putting clover in, which is also not native. And in fact, that's on invasive species lists in at least three states that I could find, Oregon, Wisconsin, and Kentucky. Nevertheless, it's what we would call naturalized in North America. It's everywhere. But it does have the potential to be invasive in landscapes because it does creep by those runners or stolons, and it does produce quite a bit of seed as well. So the real reason there's a lot of interest in this plant is that it's a legume. So legumes have that rhizobial community in their root system that allows nitrogen fixation. And so we're adding nitrogen into the soil, taking it out of the atmosphere. So that's a huge benefit of all legumes. From a lawn perspective, why do people want to put it in the lawn? And, one major reason is people are really into pollinators. That's a great thing. Interestingly, also, one of the favorite pollinators is also not native. So these two go hand in hand. But in any case, pollinators like the white clover. It tends to bloom all year, unlike dandelions, which put on a show for about 7, maybe 10 days during the spring, and then boom, there's no other flowers. Clover tends to flower all growing season. So from a pollinator perspective, I'd say it has much greater value than many of our lawn weeds, if you want to use that terminology. And then the nitrogen fixation can allow you to fertilize your lawn less if you do have a nice mix of clover in that lawn. That was one of the main reasons it was put into those lawn seed mixes back in the 20s, 30s, and 40s, was to provide fertilizer because we didn't have Scott's Turf Builder back then. And it was really hard to fertilize lawns. So the idea was to let the clover do it. There's some claims that clover might have a lower water requirement. I don't know if that's true, and I'll show you a little bit of data that I found on the water needs of clover. Some of the more important questions, just from a lawn perspective, that we really don't have a lot of answers to is, how competitive is it against other weeds? It can be a competitive plant. And in fact, it can outcompete grass in a lawn if you don't provide supplemental nitrogen. Traffic tolerance, there's some work done at University of Maryland that shows it's not something you really want to put on a soccer field, at least not as your main field, plant in that field. And again, a lot of questions about water requirements. Here's the thing, you can go on the internet, which is a dangerous place to go for information when it comes to lawns, because a lot of it's incorrect information, or you have to really be aware of where that information is coming from. It's a lot different growing a clover lawn in Maryland or Virginia, where it rains a lot, versus trying to do the same thing here in Colorado or Utah, the Western U.S., where we don't get as much rain. And so when somebody says, yeah, it doesn't need irrigation, that could be very well true in Virginia or Maryland. That's probably not going to be true out here. So take some of that information with a grain of salt when you're hunting the internet for, especially for water use information. And then, there are actually some disease problems that clover gets, usually more in the more humid parts of the United States, but it can get some diseases that will actually wipe out large patches of clover. So we don't know everything there is to know about growing this plant. Some of the more common questions I get is, what kind of clover to plant? And probably the most logical one is the white clover. Although there's some variations on that theme. One of them is something called micro clover, or sometimes called mini clover on some websites. That's simply a selection or a variety of white clover that's a dwarf version, essentially. And then, people say, should I have an all clover lawn or should I have a clover and grass mix? And, it really doesn't matter. It's pretty easy to get the grass out of a clover lawn if you want that to happen. There's a herbicide you can use to do that, but it can be a fairly happy coexistence. Again, the less you fertilize that clover grass lawn, the more likely you're going to have more clover and less grass. But eventually they'll reach an equilibrium. I doubt the grass will ever totally go away. And I doubt that the grass will ever force the clover to go away. So you can eventually reach kind of a balance there with the two. And then there's questions about how's the best way to plant a clover lawn. And so to answer some of those, we've started doing some research. We're going to have a clover lawn at one of our demonstration gardens this year. I've planted some plots on campus to look at clover, mainly because students are interested in this. And They have this pie in the sky idea of converting all the lawns on campus to clover. Little hint there, it's not going to happen, but you don't want to, dash their hopes. So I kind of go along and humor them and plant some clover lawns for them to look at. So I just thought I'd put this, and there's a lot of numbers up here, so don't get lost in this graph, but this is some data from University of Washington. And it's kind of this, really some of the best information I could find on what are some of the irrigation requirements for clover. Now, this would be for clover as a forage. So this is not where you're going to be mowing it as a lawn. So some of these numbers might be lower. But certainly up in Pullman, Washington, which has a climate quite similar to Fort Collins in the Front Range, a little bit more rain. They get about 20 inches of precipitation a year, snowy winters like we do. And you can kind of see this column shows that kind of their monthly precipitation. So not a whole lot of precipitation there. And then ET numbers are over here. All told, if you want to irrigate clover up in Washington, again, a similar climate, what they say to have really good healthy clover, you need to put about 33 inches of irrigation on, and that's above precipitation. And just for reference, we tell people for a bluegrass lawn, you can have a pretty good bluegrass lawn here for 24 with 24 inches of supplemental irrigation, and really you can do it for less than that. So that's the best data I can find on what clover needs. Again, this is for forage, that's to maximize yield, all those type of things. So, but even if it's half that, you're pretty close to what bluegrass would need to stay healthy here in Colorado. So I'm not going to say you're going to save much water having a clover lawn. It's probably going to be a comparable irrigation requirement. Again, what to use? Again, it's white clover, but here's a little picture of the micro clover, which is like a mini or dwarf version of white clover on the left, next to a white regular or normal generic white clover. So that's probably the most likely things you're going to be wanting to use. There's also strawberry clover. I'll show some pictures of that, and crimson clover, which doesn't take mowing very well. Strawberry clover will take mowing okay. Establishment, probably like if you were going to plant a grass lawn, you could probably start one now. And so we just have a lot that we don't know, a lot of questions. So if you're asking Allison questions, we don't have answers to a lot of these questions when it comes to using clover as a lawn. There are some sod farms, not in Colorado, but in other parts of the country, that are kind of addressing this demand or need, desire for clover sod, but they can't do it just with clover. So it's always got to be mixed with grass, and it's always bluegrass. So here's a picture from a sod farm that is growing a clover bluegrass sod. And that's white clover that they've mixed in. Here's the thing with the mini or the micro clovers, the two varieties, the two main ones are this one called Pirouette and Pipolina. And these are from a Netherlands seed company. So these are from Europe. And again, that's where white clover is native to. It's really only dwarfed if you mow it fairly frequently. If you stop mowing these dwarf ones, they fairly quickly become, they get the look of just the regular clover. So the mowing does contribute to the dwarf growth habit. And the idea with these mini ones was that the clover would grow beneath the canopy of the grass. And that's kind of what's seeing in this picture here. This is a picture from the Netherlands, and you don't see the clover in that lawn because they're using the dwarf one there. So the idea is that the lawn doesn't look as weedy if you perceive clover to be a weed. Not everyone does, but if you can't see it, but it's still functioning by providing nitrogen to the turf, that could be a benefit. You know, so the cost of it, you know, and the seeding rate with this, I would use somewhere around a half or 1 pound of seed per 1,000 square feet. And I just grabbed this off of a website that's selling the micro clover seed. Now, this is pelleted seed. So pelleted means that the seed has been coated with a little bit of fertilizer that actually doubles the weight of the seed. So if you're going to buy seed and you want to seed a 1,000 square foot lawn with 1 pound of seed, actually you need to buy 2 pounds of this pelleted seed, because half of what you're buying is fertilizer. So 1,000 square foot lawn with this, you would have to spend about $66 to get that seed. And this is a website that I got this last night off the internet. So that's a pretty common or current price there. And here's some pictures from the plots that I seeded just last year with the students. You know, and I had students helping me, so, you know, it was kind of suspect labor and spreading the seed and everything. But something I did notice, we had very good success seeding the clover right into the bluegrass, the existing turf grass. Actually, it seemed to work better than seeding into the bluegrass that we'd killed off. So I would say, if you want to try this at home, get some of the seed and simply spread it, rake it in vigorously into the lawn. We really didn't change watering practices that much, and that clover came up really very successfully in that bluegrass lawn that we seeded it into. So I think there's a lot of different ways to start your clover lawn, and the easiest one might just be to start overseeding your existing lawn with that clover. An alternative to the white clover might be the strawberry clover. This one is said to be more stress tolerant, actually more drought and cold tolerant even than white clover. Again, it is not native, and it probably won't take quite the shorter mowing height that the white clover will. Especially if you want the flowers, you know, and that's one of the things with the clover is, if you're going to be mowing it, you're going to be cutting the flowers off, which is what makes the clover attractive to pollinators. So the more frequently you mow, the more likely it's to form the flowers below the mowing height. So that's, it presents a conundrum, I guess I would say, of how to mow or how to manage a clover lawn. If you want the pollinators, it's probably almost a better idea really to mow it fairly infrequently to encourage the flowering. Here's that same website selling the strawberry clover seeds, 1 pound. Again, same price, but this is not pelletized seed, so you're getting twice as much. So actually the strawberry clover is a little bit cheaper per pound of seed price. So, and I think that might be kind of a fun kind of a lawn to have a mix of the white and strawberry clover in that lawn. So those are probably the two main ones. Other clovers, there are some native clovers. It's hard to get seed for those, and how well they would do in competition with turf, I couldn't even hazard a guess. But yeah, these are good candidates. Clover lawns are good candidates if you're going to do no-mow May. No-mow May, by the way, is not good for the turf. It's probably fine for the clover, but it's not a good turf management practice. We do not encourage no-mow May, at least if you want to encourage the health of your grass. But if you have a clover lawn, yeah, go for it. Don't mow your clover lawn in May, and the pollinators will be quite happy because of that. You know, something else, here's another legume. This is not one you would seed intentionally, but this is a lawn I saw a number of years ago. And I do see quite a few of these lawns throughout the year. Lawns that people aren't managing correctly, usually that means they're not fertilizing them. And I'll zoom in on the plant in this lawn. This is something called black medic, which is another legume. It's not native. Again, this is a weed that's been introduced from Europe. But this is a legume like the white clover, except it has little yellow flowers. Maybe you've seen some of this in your lawn. Very prolific creeper, very prolific seed producer. And this can become the predominant weed in lawns that are kept really dry and really infertile. In other words, without fertilizing with nitrogen. So you might be well on your way to a legume lawn if you've got a lot of black mantic. And I've actually encouraged a few people to not kill their black mantic, to actually leave it grow in their lawn and have it, you know, fertilize their lawn, because it is fixing nitrogen just like the white clover would. So that's an idea, turning a weed into a desirable lawn. So the reason this was so common in this lawn is having it fertilized for years, as far as they could recall, was underwater. They collected clippings, which is further taking nitrogen out of the lawn. So the lawn kept getting, becoming more nitrogen deficient all year. And they were mowing it really short, which favored the black mantic. So I told them if they wanted to get rid of the black mantic, you fertilize more, you raise your mowing height, you water more, you return your glass clippings, and you use a herbicide. So I don't know what they ever decided to do, but they had a pretty healthy black mantic lawn there. There are other things you can plant your lawns to, they call them pollinator mixes, and these have a bunch of different types of flowers in them, yarrows and prunella, heal-all, little other types of clovers that probably won't overwinter here. A lot of these are developed by seed companies up in the Pacific Northwest, and they tend not to fare well here after a few winters, and you end up with yarrow and fine fescue, which are the major components of those. So read the ingredients on those pollinator mixes before you buy them. And just know that most of those little flowers probably are not going to persist very long in a lawn here in Colorado, unless it's pretty well fertilized or well watered, because these pollinator mixes either were developed by University of Minnesota or Oregon State University or seed companies up there where it rains a lot, and same thing for Minnesota. So these types of lawns are going to need probably as much water as your bluegrass lawn. Okay, I'll stop here, Al, and see, are there any questions that folks had about that? I'll open the Q&A here.
Oh, there's been a lot. Could you answer Ruth's question of mixing clover with warm season grasses, and which grasses might be best if you do that?
Oh, yeah, mixing clover with warm season grass. You know, I got this question actually a week ago from someone. I'd never considered it. I don't see why it wouldn't work. Here's the thing, though, is because white clover is a cool season plant, it is going to be brilliant green during those times of the year when the buffalo grass or blue grama is dormant. And so it's going to look, in some people's eyes, it's going to look weedy. Other people will just say, oh, that looks weird. It will be striking, the difference between the color of the green clover and the dormant buffalo grass. If you don't mind that, I say go for it. If you can get a real uniform distribution of the white clover in your buffalo grass lawn, for example, that could be kind of a cool thing. I don't know. It's something to try. In fact, I may try some on some buffalo grass areas out at the fairgrounds this year, just to see what happens with it. It's a cool idea. I'd give it a try, but no promises there. Let's see, would you spread seeds before or after fertilizer? It doesn't matter. Just be sure you're not putting a pre-emerge on with that fertilizer if you're going to overseed your clover. Will clover outcompete bindweed? No. How do you prepare grass for the clover seed? You know, if you wanted to, here's one thing. What we did is I just scalped the grass really low. I cut the grass as short as the mower would go, and then we seeded into it. And that seemed to work pretty well. The clover seed germinated really well and pretty aggressively. I was surprised. I would not have expected it. So I don't think there's a lot of preparation you have to do. So are there any lawn type plants that grow in the shade? A fine fescue. Okay, very good. Let's go on to organic lawn care and see if I can do these 70 slides in a half an hour. I know what the over-under, where Al's betting on that one. So this is kind of a transition organic, but you know, clover lawns kind of pair well with organic lawn care. And why do people want to do organic lawn care? You just don't like pesticides, or you're concerned about your kids or your dog's health, and they're playing on the lawn, and you don't want to be putting that kind of stuff on the lawn for them to play. I totally understand that. You know, environmental concerns, pollinators, birds, all totally legit, valid reasons. Sometimes you're required to, and this is more, you know, schools sometimes require that their school grounds go organic or whatever. But from a homeowner perspective, I think a lot of times it's the first two. You just don't want to use synthetic stuff on your lawns, or you have very specific environmental concerns. So those are totally legit reasons for wanting to go organic. You know, some obstacles to it, though. Why doesn't everyone go organic? And some of them are, quite honestly, if you don't know what you're doing, the lawn can start to look weedy. And weeds are often the most common pest problem when you transition to organic lawn production. You know, and then lacking sometimes effective pest management tools. But a lot of it's just expertise, just not knowing what to do. Overreacting when you do get pest problems, or not reacting soon enough, not knowing just how to handle problems as they come up. And probably the biggest thing is it involves change, and people don't like change. And that's really what it comes down to. So you're probably not going to save money on lawn care going organic. It's probably going to be more expensive, especially if you hire a lawn care company to do things truly organically. And a word of warning there, since nobody really knows what organic lawn care means, there's no legal definition, there's no regulation. A lawn care company can tell you they're doing things organically, and it can be so far from what I would consider to be organic that I would say they're kind of cheating on you and charging you more money for it, and probably doing things a lot from a synthetic perspective, but they're banking on you not questioning what they're doing, or not understanding what they're doing, or not caring what they're doing, and taking their word for it. So that's a buyer beware thing if you're enlisting the services of organic lawn care. Still seeing questions on the clover. Is strawberry clover more xeric and heat tolerant than white clover? It's more cold tolerant, probably. I don't know about heat. It's supposedly more drought resistant and gets very deep roots. So that's what I've read about it. Will grasshoppers eat clover? Of course they will. Okay, let's see. So a lot of times with organic conversions, people have unrealistic expectations. They think it's going to go smoothly. It usually isn't. They think they're not going to have pest problems. Probably not true. Sometimes the claims or promises made by organic lawn care are unrealistic. So you still have to do the common sense. You have to mow tall. You still have to fertilize. You still have to irrigate. You just can't stop doing the common sense, normal lawn care practices because you're using organic fertilizer. Sometimes it's never going to work. If you're trying to do organic lawn care in a really shady lawn where you got bluegrass planted and the bluegrass is doing terribly already, organic lawn care is not going to fix that problem. So you have to choose the right places to do organic lawn care. You have to start with healthy grass to start. If you're starting with a lawn full of weeds, you're going to have an organic lawn care, a lawn full of weeds. It's just that you're going to be growing weeds organically. So there's nothing magical or mystical about organic lawn care. It's just another way of doing things. So set your expectations realistically, and do your homework. And you know, here, this talking about unrealistic expectations. This is a park, and I won't say what town it was I went into. They hired a consultant, paid him boatloads of money, and he basically lied to these folks, and they converted, quote unquote, converted their parks to organic. and they were told a bunch of lies about how to fertilize and what to fertilize with, and they got ripped off terribly. I felt so bad for these folks. And this is what their premier soccer field was looking like in that town. And this is, again, they just believe this consultant, and this guy still practices. In fact, he teaches webinars in the state of Colorado, and people believe what he says. But anyway, and this whole field was thin. It was not growing enough to take the traffic from the soccer kids. You know, there are places where you just don't want to go organic. You just need to fertilize and do some pest management if you're going to provide a safe playing surface. And so this was not the place to do organic parks, you know, management. But you can see all the mature. This is plantain. It was the healthiest plantain infestation I've ever seen. And then these are all seedlings coming up. So this park was rapidly going from what used to be perfect grass to like 95% weeds in the space of just a couple of years of mismanagement. So again, realistic expectations is really important. Okay, so what do we have to do? What do we need to do? Or what tools do we need for organic lawn care? So fertilizers is the logical place. And we have had organic fertilizers forever. So before we had synthetic fertilizers, we used manure for fertilizer on golf courses and parks and lawns. We didn't have synthetics. And then synthetics came along and organic fertilizers kind of fell out of, you know, favor because they're expensive. They don't have a lot of nitrogen in them. So you're shipping and moving and bagging and storing a lot of stuff just to store a little bit of nitrogen. So synthetics are more concentrated, so they're more efficient to fertilize with, and their cost per pound of nitrogen is lower, and you get more rapid reaction from the turf, and there's a lot of benefits to synthetics that organic fertilizers can't provide. So we've had these fertilizers for years, and there are a lot of good ones out there. We've got a couple of really good ones that are made in Colorado. So one is shown here called Rich Lawn. The Rich Lawn Company uses dehydrated poultry waste. Another one is Alpha Lawn, which uses and recycles alfalfa. Both made in Colorado, both outstanding organic fertilizers. And I encourage people to use those all the time. You know, and I would say use those over instead of Turf Builder. Turf Builder's made in Ohio. And, you know, be a local supporter and use fertilizers made here in Colorado. So Rich Lawn or Alpha Lawn. But there's lots of stuff that goes in organic fertilizers, and it's kind of a regional thing. Fish fertilizers are from the coastlines. Corn gluten meal and alfalfa meal from the Midwest. Cotton seed meal is from Texas. Peanut meal is from Georgia. So you have these regionally created and base kind of fertilizers, and it's cheaper to use a local fertilizer like Rich Lawn or Alpha Lawn than to ship something from the West Coast or East Coast simply because it's got fish meal in it. So keep that in mind when you're choosing your fertilizers. Look at where they're sourced. Some of the basic types are, one of them is what we call biosolids, and the most common and most widely known one is called milorganite. This is from the Milwaukee Sanitary District, been around since the 1920s. When I was a golf course superintendent in a previous life in Chicago, this is all I used in my golf course. Beautiful fertilizer, wonderful stuff. And it's become quite favored here in Colorado because it seems to discourage rabbit and vole activity in your lawn. So if you have a lot of rabbit feeding or if you have voles, you can apply milorganite, and they tend to want to go to other lawns because this stuff just doesn't smell good to them. But you have to apply it probably 4 or 5 times a year to get that animal repellent activity, but great organic fertilizer. Then we have the animal-based manures from chickens or turkeys are the most common ones. We call DPW or dehydrated poultry waste. Here's one from Minnesota called Sustain. We've got the Rich Lawn here, made with chicken, sustains from turkey litter. And so these are great fertilizers too. The common thing you notice on all these is that first number is low. Here's this is a four with the mill organ. I can't see the oh yeah the number is there 6%. So you have to apply a lot of these. You have to apply 25 pounds of sustain per 1,000 square feet to give you 1 pound of nitrogen. So that's, you know, that's a lot of bags of that stuff you got to buy. Here's good old Alpha Lawn, also made in Colorado. And so this is made, so some of our fertilizers are made from you know, human waste material, animal waste material. Others are made from plant material. So like Alpha Lawn's made from alfalfa, corn gluten meal's made from corn. So, and so these are great fertilizers as well. Here's some made from meat meal and bone meal. So these have more energy in them, some people claim. So these are better, perhaps better for the soil because microbes can use these as a food source. They get more energy eating meat meal, bone meal, and blood meal and fish meal than they get out of eating chicken poop is the best way to think about it. So what would you rather eat if you were a microbe? I guess that's the question you want to ask yourself. And then another way of fertilizing is with the microclover. So that's where you seed, where the white clovers seed into your lawn. And that's just another way of maybe fertilizing naturally. So we already talked about that. Although here's those two legumes I talked about, and I forgot I had this picture. There's white clover on the left and the black medic on the right. And you can see how green the grass is growing right in there where the grass is growing with the black medic. It's the grass is much greener than where the black medic isn't. So the black medic is fertilizing, as is the white clover here. It's fertilizing the grass that it's growing right next to. So that fertilization is working. So we've talked about that. Some of the organic things you can do to your lawn. Compost top dressing. Now, this is not really a great source of nitrogen, so don't equate this with fertilizing. There's a little bit of nitrogen in compost, but it's not. It should not be your main source of nitrogen. This is more a manner or a way of getting organic matter into your soil, maybe leveling the lawn a little bit if you have a lumpy lawn, maybe from night crawlers. So if you have a very lumpy lawn from night crawlers, you've kind of got to start towards an organic lawn. But it's a very bumpy lawn. And so by applying compost, you can smooth that lawn out. And this is going to be a pretty common practice in lawn care, even if it's not a totally organic lawn service. Many lawn care companies are starting to offer this option of applying compost to homeowner lawns because they do see some benefits to it. Here's some pictures from a colleague, University of Illinois, where he's looked at compost top dressing. This is from University of Wisconsin, sorry. And he's looking in, you know, they have good soils in the Midwest, nice soils in Madison, Wisconsin. But nevertheless, he's found benefits to applying compost to good old average Kentucky bluegrass turf there. And he's found a couple benefits. One of them is that just using conventional fertilizer over many years versus applying compost, and actually this is compost with organic fertilizer, that there's even a benefit of adding the compost on top of the organic fertilizer, and that it helps the thatch layer to decompose. Plus, also look at how you get kind of this filtering of organic matter deeper into the soil. So the organics, they become water soluble and they kind of move down into that root zone and benefit the soil. So there are some potential great benefits to using compost top dressing, but don't look at it as a fertilizer source. It's more in addition to fertilizer. What about pests that we might get into lawns? This is where we start to see maybe some fall off in availability of products. So we have a lot of organic fertilizers, lots of them. Gets to be a little shorter list when it comes to pest management, but we do have some good pest management alternatives for insects. And one that's been around, again, for this is ideas really been around 40 or 50 years, but really 30 years in the turf industry, is having what we call endophyte enhanced grasses. And this is where there's a fungus in the seed. When you buy the grass seed, you plant this grass seed, and the fungus grows inside the plant as it grows and matures. And for the life of that plant, the fungus is living inside the plant, but only in the leaves of the plant. So only above ground. The fungus doesn't live in the roots. And so what's so cool about this? Well, that fungus makes the grass taste terrible to insects. So like sod webworms, army worms, bilbug adults, anything that feeds on the leaves of grass plants. We don't have a lot of those pests here in Colorado. In the Midwest, they have lots of those leaf feeding insects, army worms and sod webworms especially. They don't like to feed on this grass when it has this endophyte in it. Here's the thing, the endophyte won't move through the soil. It won't move through grass clippings. So it's in the grass clippings when you mow, but just leaving the grass clippings or spreading them in other parts of your lawn, it doesn't spread the endophyte. It has to come into the plant from the seed. So you have to buy seed with the endophyte. And it'll tell you right on the label that it's endophyte enhanced. Here's the other thing. This will not work with bluegrass. Bluegrass doesn't have endophytes in it. Ryegrasses do, fescues do, but ryegrass doesn't, bentgrass doesn't. The two most used grasses, ryegrass or bluegrass and bentgrass, don't have endophytes in them. And companies have spent millions and millions and millions of dollars over the last 20 years trying to get endophytes to grow in these. Because the endophytes don't grow in the roots, grubs are not bothered by these. So Japanese beetle will not be bothered by endophyte enhanced turf. So it does have its limitations, but it's an option. It's a pretty cool one out there. We do have sprayable products, or products you can put through a spreader, that have microbes in them that will kill insects. The most commonly heard of one, called milky spore disease, that one doesn't work. I put it on this slide just to remind me to tell you that it really, I'm being charitable here, say largely ineffective. That's another way of saying it doesn't work. So even though it's sold in our very good garden centers, I saw it sold in Bath and Four Counts Nursery and Fossil Creek, all those good places, they sell it. They're great nurseries. This stuff doesn't work. And I would tell them that I would not bother selling this stuff. And certainly I would not buy it. But there are ones you can buy that do work really well, especially the last one, the Bacillus thuringiensis galleriae. So that's sold under products called Beetle Gone or Grub Gone. And the Bacillus products, they work well on the grubs, but they will also work on the adults. So this is a cool thing, is the Beetle Gone is a sprayable form of this that you can spray in your roses, you can spray in your grapes, and it'll kill your adult Japanese beetle. But then you get the granular one, the Grub Gone. It's the very same bacillus, the same microbe, and you apply that to your lawn and it'll kill the grubs. So this is a great product. It sells out so fast because people have discovered this, and there are only a couple companies in the United States that make this stuff. Another one is called Grub Halt. Grub Halt is a granular one, same thing as the Grub Gone. So these are, and if you just Google Grub Gone or Beetle Gone, it'll take you right to the website for the company that sells this stuff. So I would order that stuff early. Gardens Alive sells it, and there are a couple other websites that sell organic products, but they sell out of it really, really quickly. Other options, insect pathogenic nematodes. These are little worms. You buy these things. I say it's like buying sushi. These are living organisms you buy. You spray them out on your lawn. They get into the little grub and they reproduce inside the grub and they kill the grub. And then they go out looking for other ones. So these can be very effective. The thing is that neither one of these will overwinter. So you have to reapply these things every year. especially the nematodes. And if you apply the nematodes in the afternoon on a sunny day and you don't water them in, they're going to be dead from the sun, the ultraviolet light. So think of these like vampires. Apply them right before dark and water them in, and you're going to have the best chance of these. And apply them fresh. So buy these things. There's an expiration date on them. You have to buy the right one. Buy the one that's called Nemaseek, the ones that seek, and then apply them. If you don't apply them right away, put them in your refrigerator to keep them from going bad. So the parasitic nematodes, these work good. So I saw the question, what do you recommend for Japanese beetles? Answering that one right now. The biological control, the grub gone, works great on Japanese beetles. Nema shield works great on Japanese beetles. So if you want to do the organic ones, very good options. The milky spore does not work on Japanese beetle. Do not buy it for a Japanese beetle or any other grub. Pheromones. These work to attract Japanese beetle, but these don't kill Japanese beetle. Unless you empty the bag every day and kill those things, but the odds are you're going to attract more beetles to your landscape than you're going to kill. These are handy for knowing when the Japanese beetles are flying. So here's what you do with the pheromones. Is you do put these out, and then once you start getting Japanese beetle in your pheromone trap, that's when you start applying. I would wait about a week, maybe 10 days, and then apply the nematodes or the grub gone microbial and water it in. That way, the nematodes or the bacteria is in place when the little eggs hatch from the Japanese beetle and you get the little grubs. So that's what the pheromone traps are good for. Here's what else is good for grubs. And this is an insecticide. It's not technically organic. This is as close as you're going to get to organic, though. So this is derived from a naturally occurring fungus. And so the Scotts Grubex material, the chemical is called acelaprin. This is just dynamite on all grubs. Japanese beetle, the mast chafer, which we also get in Colorado, bill bugs, it'll get sod webworms. It gets anything that lives in the soil as a turf insect species, but it doesn't harm earthworms. It does not harm pollinators. It's absolutely 100% pollinator safe, people safe, pet safe, kid safe, everything else safe. It's just bad if you're a grub. And this stuff, the cost you get it at with Scotts, with Grubex, and I rarely promote Scotts products, but this is one I promote wholeheartedly, 100%. And endorse because no other company sells this, at least in the combination of that Scott sells it and at the price point. This is an amazing bargain. The Grubex for grubs. And I would put this on probably sometime around June 15th, and it'll protect your lawn from grubs the entire year. And again, totally safe. It doesn't even have a signal word, it has no caution, warning, or danger on it. It's that safe for humans, wildlife, pollinators. So seriously consider this, even if you're kind of an anti-pesticide person, I get that. This is the safest pesticide you'll ever use. This is safer than the flea collars you're putting on your cats or dogs. As far as weeds go, we don't have a lot of good options for organic weed management for turf. This one is promoted as organic weed control. The long story short, just take my word for it, folks. It doesn't work as a weed control product. It would work if you applied it at unreasonably high rates, but then you'd be mowing your lawn about every other day because the lawn would be growing so fast because of all the fertilizer you're putting in. If you want to use this as a fertilizer, wonderful. It's a great fertilizer. But it does not provide the level of weed control that the websites, that the bags, that they promote. So great fertilizer. And so some companies quite honestly, and I would say, ethically, have started promoting this as a lawn food, and they don't make promises for weed control. Other companies, they say it prevents weeds and feeds lawns. Well, it feeds the lawns, so they're half right there. And if you don't believe me, you can go to all these universities that have done research to demonstrate that the weed control benefits from corn gluten meal are zero to almost immeasurable. So take my word for it on that. There are other things that can do weed control organically. The ones I'll show you here, these are non-selective burn down products. These are okay. Cracks in your driveway, in your flagstone, in your gravel driveway, in your patio, maybe in your vegetable garden. These are non-selective. They'll turn anything brown that you spray. Some of them contain vinegar, citric acid. There's all kinds of these things out there. The idea is you burn the plant back, it doesn't grow back. If it's a seedling, if it's a mature plant, if it's a dandelion, you may have to spray it 4 or 5 times to finally kill it. Okay. So this is what they do. They turn a green plant to brown, like overnight. There's a good chance that this crabgrass plant will grow back, though. It's probably not been totally killed. Okay. You can try doing this on a lawn, but here's what happens. It also burns the lawn. And so this is the actual picture. Like 2 weeks later, after I sprayed this stuff, and you can't spray just the weed, you're going to spray the bluegrass. And you can see it turned the bluegrass brown. And what's coming back just as quickly as the bluegrass is the weed. So these things don't work except for very, very small seedling plants. So use these early in the year, this time of year, when you start seeing little tiny weeds growing in your vegetable bed or your flower bed or your gravel driveway. What can work in a home lawn that's natural or organic? This is not technically organic, but this is iron. There are products that just contain very concentrated iron, which will burn the leaves of broadleaf plants. So it doesn't work on grassy weeds like crabgrass, but on dandelions and spurge and purslane, those broadleaf weeds growing in your lawn, plantain, even thistle, it'll burn them back. Now, these will regrow. This dandelion probably regrew 3 times before I finally killed it, but it burns those leaves back. And that's how you kill it, is it has to use energy to regrow. And you keep depleting the energy, and then it runs out of energy to finally grow back. And that's how you eventually kill that plant. Some other interesting ones that are sold now, again, this would not be used in your lawn, but stuff that I found work fantastically well. Yeah, not in the lawn, but like in your vegetable garden, your driveway. This stuff called caprylic acid. This shows 2 hours after spraying a puncture vine, and that puncture vine was dead, 100% killed. If you don't get full cover, though, you only spray half of it, you're only going to kill half of it. So there's no systemic activity with these. So you need 100% cover, but this caprylic acid stuff works really well. As far as organic disease management, we just don't have good options. There's nothing even for golf course superintendents that works really well. So that's kind of the holy grail for organic lawn care, is finding organic disease management tools. Luckily here in Colorado, we don't have severe problems with disease. And if we do, if it's necrotic ring spots, our biggest disease, and that's a watering problem. So that one's pretty easy to solve. Let's see. What about rabbits? So again, going back to the mill organite, rabbits don't like the smell of this stuff. And if you put it out frequently enough, and they can find another food source. Now, if your lawn is the only one that's like worth eating, they're going to stay in your lawn. But if there are neighbor lawns and they have ways to get to the neighbor lawns, they'll tend to leave your lawn if you're applying the mill organite. So, there are other things that you can spray, incredibly expensive. They don't last very long. So you're reapplying these things over and over and over again. But there are other options out there. this is, I guess you would call this organic or natural, but fencing exclusion is the best solution for rabbits. Make sure it's fine enough that will Morganite repel gophers? No. It'll repel voles, but not gophers. Good question. And we don't have moles in Colorado. No matter how much you want to argue with me, we don't have moles. We have voles. But yeah, excluding rabbits is the way to go. Here's this is a funny one though. I went to this property and these people, they put the fencing up to exclude the rabbits, except they had fenced the rabbits into their property. They didn't realize they were all living under their deck. So the rabbits were still feeding on their lawns. And you can see the shrub back here where the rabbits were feeding on the green part of that shrub. So I had to show them where the rabbits were living under their deck. So before you do the fencing, make sure you don't fence them in, that you fence them out. And then finally, the milorganite here. Again, this is something you can apply in every part of your landscape. So voles, they'll live under your junipers, and they love living under your weed barrier. If you were enough to put that down under your mulch, or you had a contractor that did it, or you bought the house with weed barrier, voles love that stuff. They have nice cozy homes under it. They live under it all winter. And if you have junipers with weed barrier, you've created an oasis for voles. So apply the milorganite, in the fall liberally, and there's a good chance that the voles, at least they won't come out and cause damage into your lawn. So golf courses up in the mountains do this. They also spray red pepper spray on the turf in addition to the milorganite. So they use multi-pronged approaches, but they apply this stuff along their native areas where the voles like to come out of. We don't like to encourage the poison baits for voles, even though pest control companies will do it. You always run the risk of a curious dog or something finding those, or a sick vole comes out that's been poisoned by the thing, and then your dog or your cat consumes that vole. So we're not real big on poison pellets for these, even though they do work. They do work. Have to tell you that up front. They do work, but be very, very cautious with those. And I would say it's much safer to do the milorganite. At worst, your dog may lick it and get a little upset stomach. Another thing you can do organically, or naturally, I guess, is put mouse traps in the trails. And this shows, and you don't even have to bait these things. You just put the mouse traps in the trails facing the right direction and just have two of them in each trail facing out, and the voles will run onto these. They're just creatures of habit, and they'll get trapped. And sorry if you're offended by the vole there, but as one of my colleagues, this is the advice I give him, and he sent me a picture. He says, oh my gosh, this works. He sent me a picture of the deceased vole from his yard. So
other than that, thank you so much, Tony. Thanks for joining us today, and we hope to see you at a future webinar. Take care.
Thanks, everyone.